Hello, everybody. Let's get started. It's 11, so it's great to see you all in the chat, especially early. So welcome back to Gearing Up, and we have a new episode every weekday from 11 a.m. Just before we get started, is the audio and video okay? Can I just get a thumbs up? Everything good? I think it should be fine. So my name is Sana, and I'm new to Gearing Up, which is why you've probably never seen me before. And you're going to see a lot of me around because I'm new to the live stream team at Gearing Up. So I'm actually going to be here next Thursday too, so that's exciting. And I'm going to try to make this video as interactive as possible. I'm going to ask questions and feel free to reply in the chat or if you have any questions throughout the stream, put in the chat and then I'll reply live if I can. We also have a Kahoot at the end of this stream, so make sure you pay attention so you can get those Kahoot questions, and that should be good. So, I really like science, and I really like eating and food, and I've learned that during the quarantine. I just keep eating, and so I'm really excited about this week. The theme for this week, if you've been watching the past videos, is the science of food. So today, we're gonna merge my two passions, and we are going to talk about chocolate tempering. So you may not know what chocolate tempering actually is, but we're gonna go over that through the stream, and it'll become super clear. So has anyone bought like chocolate dipped strawberries or like a chocolate bar or cake pops before and ever looked at that chocolate? And if you have, you know that it's really visually appealing, right? It's shiny, it's glossy, it looks good. And even if you like bite into it, it has a nice little snap to it, right? And you don't want to have something that's visually just not nice to eat. Right? Which is why the chocolatiers do this procedure called chocolate tempering, and that's what makes the chocolate so nice. So over here on our left, we can see a comparison between tempered and untempered chocolate. I'm gonna specifically define it a little bit later. So we can see that the tempered chocolate, it's glossy, we can see in that photo, it looks like it's nice and shiny. I would eat that, right? And then right next to it, we have untempered chocolate. And it doesn't necessarily need to have those little white spots in it, but untempered chocolate is a little bit dull. It doesn't look as appealing. It's not shiny. It's not glossy. Now, another thing about tempered chocolate and the reason why the chocolate that we buy at the stores and our chocolate bars are very pretty and they're shiny is because they're tempered, they have a nice little snap to them. And I'm going to show that to you. So we have this chocolate bar, and chocolate bars that are just store-bought are all tempered. So I'm gonna hold it up to the mic and you're gonna hear a nice snap. This is gonna be like some ASMR. I think you guys will like it. So listen closely. You can hear that, right? Like that's a distinctive snap. And it's that snap that's created when we temper chocolate. So I'm gonna show you some chocolate that I made yesterday, and it's untempered chocolate. And then I'm gonna show you the chocolate that I tempered. And in this live stream, we're actually gonna temper some chocolate together. And we're gonna see how we can take that dull chocolate and make it super shiny. So I'm gonna get closer to the camera. Here is some chocolate that that is untempered. I made it yesterday. You can see that it's not very appealing. It's quite dull. Someone said it even looks like chalk. So that's not very appealing, right? Like you wouldn't wanna buy chocolate that looks like this. Someone in the chat said that they don't like chocolate, and I wouldn't like chocolate that looks this chalky and gross and dull either, which is why we temper it. Now, I'm gonna give a side-by-side comparison to a chocolate bar, which is tempered, and you're gonna see how big that difference is. So this is the tempered chocolate, and you can see it's nice and shiny, right? Like it's glistening. That looks good, someone said in the chat, Fiona. And you can see just a side-by-side comparison, and which one would you eat, right? So you can really see that this procedure does something to the chocolate. This is dull, this is nice and shiny, and I'm gonna try snapping this untempered chocolate for you. And you remember that distinctive nice snap that we had with the tempered chocolate? Now, listen really closely to see what you hear. Not much, right? Because there's no snap. And it actually, it crumbles really easily. And you might say that's because it's so thin, but it's actually not even that. It crumbles so easily in your hand and it's flaky. It clearly doesn't look like that tempered chocolate. If you don't see a difference, you might want to try just looking. I know Fiona said that in the chat.
just look at that nice shine that we have for this tempered chocolate. You can see that it glistens, right? It's a little bit lighter too. And this untempered chocolate, you don't really see anything. It's pretty like dull.
So there's quite a bit of visual differences. So I think I've said the word chocolate tempering in the stream probably 100 times. And if you don't know what chocolate tempering is, you might be a little bit confused. So I'm gonna tell you exactly what it is. So it's a procedure that chocolatiers do, and anybody making chocolate, they do it in professional kitchens. And you might have done it at home if you were like dipping something in chocolates and you wanted it to look nice. And what you do is you heat the chocolate up to a really, really specific temperature, and then you cool it down just a bit, then you reheat it, and then you finally cool it down. You might spread it on like a marble slab just to help with the cooling. And that is chocolate tempering. It's just heating and bringing it down and bringing it back up. And that will help make the chocolate nice and shiny because of the alignment of the crystals. Another thing is that tempered chocolate won't melt that easily in your hands. So if I have this chocolate bar right here and I try heating it up with my hands, we're not gonna see any like clear residue on it. And what's actually happening here is when we temper chocolate, is we are helping with the alignment of the crystals in this chocolate. And when we make specific crystals in this chocolate, then these crystals, if we have the correct type, they're gonna line up right next to each other, super tight, and that's what causes that nice snap, because we're breaking those tight crystals. It's what creates the nice shine. Let's talk a little bit more about the science, get into the logistics here, science-wise and crystal-wise. So in chocolate, we have cocoa butter. And cocoa butter is just the fat that is in the cocoa bean. And cocoa butter is the reason why you have to temper chocolate. Cocoa butter is what forms the crystals in the chocolate. There are 6 types of crystals that cocoa butter can form, and we can see that all here in this chart. I'm gonna go over the chart a little bit more in detail. There's a lot of words there, but there's 6 different types of cocoa butter crystals, and we don't want just any type of crystal. For example, if we have type 1 or type 2 or type 3 crystal, then this isn't gonna form a nice shiny chocolate. We want a crystal that perfectly lines up with the other crystals of its type, nice and straight, nice and ordered, and that will help create a beautiful, glossy, firm, snappy chocolate. And the type of crystal that is a type 5 crystal. And this might come up in the Kahoot, so just remember type 5. So what's actually happening when we melt the chocolate? Because tempering just means that heating and cooling and that heating again and that final cooling, right? So what happens is that these crystals all have different properties. They're not exactly the same. And if you can see from the graph, you can see that this property that's a little bit different is the melting point. They all have different melting points. So now that we see that there's a difference between these crystals, we can probably isolate the crystal that we want if we manipulate the property that they differ in. So we can see that the type 5 crystal, as you go from the top to the bottom of the chart, the melting point of the crystals will increase, which means it takes more temperature, it takes more energy to be able to melt that certain type of crystal. And we can see the type 5 crystal, which is just a V and Roman numerals. I never understood Roman numerals. When I was in high school, I would have such a hard time. I would be like reading text and I'd be like I instead of saying 3. Anyways, it can be a little tricky if you're like me, but type 5 crystals have a high melting point, and they actually have the highest melting point out of all of the crystals that form. You might look at the table and you might say, hey, like, what about number 6? That's right below it. But number 6 actually takes weeks to form, so that's not going to be the crystals that's forming when we actually heat it up. That takes weeks, and that's not something we have to worry about. So now we know that type 5 crystals have the highest melting point. So if we put the temperature of the chocolate at some point that it melts every single type of crystal except the type 5 crystal, then we can isolate these type 5 crystals. That's what we want to create. I'm going to give you a little bit of an analogy just to understand this crystals. It can be a lot of numbers like type 1, type 2, type 3. It might be a little bit confusing. And I know everything that I remember in school is just because like a teacher gave me an analogy and I remember that. So I want you to think of this bowl that has
many different grains in it. You can see the different sizes of grains as our chocolate.
And we want to isolate for our particular type of grain in this mixture. We want to isolate for these big green ones. And we know that these grains differ in the property of size. So this is a metaphor for the chocolate that has crystals that have different melting points. So there's one property that was different between them, the different between the grains. In this case, it's size. So I'm gonna get a nice sifter. And I know that I want to isolate just the big green grains that are in here. So I'm gonna get my sifter, and I know that if I pour it in the sifter and don't do anything with my hand at all, some of the smaller unwanted grains are gonna get out. Let me just move this so you can see it better. Some of the unwanted grains are gonna get out, but we still have some of the small grains because I didn't shake it, I didn't do anything. And this sifter is analogous for the temperature of the chocolate. We know if we take it to a very specific temperature, then it's going to isolate our type 5 crystals. And in this case, we know if we shake it in a very specific way, if I shake this sifter, then we are going to isolate the grains that we want. And we can see that we have these nice green grains that we wanted now. So this is just a metaphor for separating the component that you want out of the chocolate by using very specific parameters. So we know that if we shake it just a certain way, all of these smaller grains are going to fall out and we have these nice bigger grains. So I hope that helps with your understanding. By the way, this smells awful. These grains are garlic powder, salt, sugar. So it's not the best smelling thing, but that's okay. The chocolate we're going to make soon is going to help with that. So now we're getting a little bit closer to actually doing the procedure for our experiment in this live stream. We are going to take this ugly chocolate that I showed you before that was quite dull, and we are going to make that into nice shiny chocolate. Then we're going to play a little cuckoo game. So what is our procedure? The first thing that we're going to do, we can see all the types of crystals right over here on the left, and we can see that their melting points is written underneath them. We are trying to isolate, again, for number 5, for crystal number 5, and we can see that those crystals, if they line up right next to each other, they're going to form a nice arrayed, organized crystal lattice structure, which is what we want, which is what gives that nice snap sound when we break that chocolate. So what we are going to do first is we are going to heat to 50 degrees, because what we're going to do is we're going to basically think of it as like burning all the buildings down and creating new buildings on top. So if we heat it to 50 degrees Celsius, then all of the crystals are going to get destroyed in the chocolate because it's above the melting point of literally every crystal in that chocolate. So everything's going to get destroyed. Then we're going to cool it down. We're going to take it to 27 degrees Celsius. And if we look at this chart, we see that type 4 and type 5 crystals are going to be made if we cool it down to 27 degrees Celsius. But you're probably thinking, but we want type 5 crystals. Why would we want type 4 crystals? So then we reheat that to 31 degrees, and we have now isolated for type 5 crystals, because 31 degrees is below the melting point of type 5 crystals. That's not going to melt, and it is above the melting point of all other crystals. Okay, so what are the materials that we need for this experiment that we're going to do? We're going to do the experiment and then the Kahoot. I know you guys are very excited for that Kahoot. Somebody asked about the flame. I don't know what that is. Is that like a McDonald's reference? But the flame for the heat right over here, you might hear a little bubbling. That's just because I have my water boiling as I'm talking. I don't want to make you guys wait for that water to boil. But that takes us into the materials that we're going to need for this live stream experiment. So we're going to obviously need chocolate. We're going to use this nice 90% chocolate that I showed you before. I actually untempered it before this live stream. It's the chocolate that I showed you before. Super dull. So that you guys can see the difference of me when I make it nice and shiny. We're going to need a bowl where we have all of our chocolate in it right over here. A little spoon just to stir it when it's melting. Then we have a candy thermometer. Remember that temperature is super, super important in this experiment. We need to monitor it closely. And to do that, we have nice fancy thermometers for that. And I also have a marble slab here that you can probably see, and this is going to help with the cooling. I also have an ice bath prepared over here to help with the cooling of the chocolate. Okay, let's get to the experiment. So what we're gonna do, let me point my camera a little bit lower so that you guys can see and move this disgusting garlic powder away from me. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna get this chocolate, and remember, we're gonna heat to 50 degrees Celsius just to melt every single type of crystal that is in here. It might take a little while for it to melt. I'm gonna turn it as high as possible. And in order to monitor the temperature once it's melting a little bit, I'm gonna put this nice thermometer in there. So now's a really good time. If you have any questions, ask them in the chat. I can answer them live while we're waiting for this chocolate to melt. But for now, I can talk about how even chocolate that is tempered can actually become untempered. Because if you remember from that diagram I showed you before, there were type 6 crystals. But type 6 crystals aren't actually forming because it takes weeks to form. So if you ever saw some like gross chocolate at the bottom of your mom's purse or something and it looks like there's like white bubbles in it, those are type 6 crystals that are forming. They do take weeks to form, so it's nothing that we're gonna see today, but they create pretty gross looking chocolate. Somebody asked, what chocolate is that? I think Leonardo asked that. It is not my favorite chocolate, definitely. It is 90% cocoa chocolate. So I don't know if any of you guys have had like really, really dark chocolate before, like 90% or 99% chocolate, but it's pretty bitter. It's not my favorite, definitely. But that's actually a really important question because dark chocolate is very rich in cocoa. And remember we said that the crystals that are forming are actually in the cocoa butter, which is in the cocoa. So the less cocoa that we have, the less crystals that we have. So this would be very difficult to, make if we had milk chocolate or white chocolate, because obviously that has less cocoa. Somebody says, can you eat type 6 crystals? You can eat it. You definitely won't die or anything. If you ever had gross looking chocolate, I know my mom, she would always keep chocolate in her purse for a very, very long time. So always at the bottom, you'd find the most just filthy chocolate. And I would eat it. I'm here today, so I think it's fine. But it will definitely affect the taste. It won't taste as fresh. And type 6 crystals, what they do is they ruin the crystal structure of the type 5 crystals and they interfere with them. And because of that, it creates these white bubbles. And they're actually more stable than the type 5 crystals, which is why that they form over time. So we wanna be sure if anybody actually ends up doing this at home, is we wanna be sure to monitor the temperature the entire time. It's definitely not a great time to be wearing a sweater. I'm sweating. But we want to be super careful that we don't accidentally heat it up too much because that can actually cause our chocolate not to temper. And I see that it's at 40 degrees right now. And thermometers sometimes take a while to show an accurate reading. So I'm just gonna take it off right now. If you guys remember, we're heating it up to 50 degrees Celsius. It's also really hot, so I'm gonna use a nice oven mitt. And I'm gonna put it on my cool marble slab. And I have an ice bath over here. We're gonna monitor the temperature still because we wanna make sure that it gets to 50 degrees Celsius. And we are going to put it into an ice bath. And I got a question from Samuel. Hey, Sana, if we're using a hot plate at home, what are some safety checks that we should do? Oh, what a great question. So you wanna be sure that if you're a girl, you're not getting your hair up in there, it would be best to tie your hair. You wanna make sure that you're not wearing loose clothing. I unfortunately did not have my lab coat yet, but it would be super smart to wear clothes that won't get in this hot plate and cause like a fire. So we wanna be super cautious of that. If we're a little bit younger, it can definitely burn our hands. So if you're younger, please, please get your parent to help you with this water because it is boiling water. So safety check, that's what Fiona said, I like that. So yeah, that's super important to remember. So somebody else said, how does cocoa make crystals? So cocoa actually has cocoa butter in it. and its specific structure of cocoa butter forms crystals, and it forms many types of crystals. Those are the six crystals that we talked about. So it's not like the sugar or anything that's in the chocolate. The sugar doesn't really matter. It's the cocoa butter that's lining up with the other like cocoa butter molecules that are making the crystals. Can you use an induction stove? You for sure can. This is just the hot plate that I had at hand. I actually did it on my induction stove before and it worked 100%. You don't need to worry about that. So just a little update on our chocolate. It is at 48.7 degrees Celsius. We want to be super precise with this temperature, because if it goes too much over, if it doesn't go high enough, then we're not gonna make the correct type of crystals. And yeah, I'm loving the questions in the chat, so keep those coming. I'm just gonna put this in an ice bath, because remember, we are going to cool this down, because chocolate tempering, I know there's some people who joined a little bit late, chocolate tempering is when you heat up to a certain temperature, then you cool it down, you heat it up again, and then you cool it down. So what I'm doing right now is I see that my thermometer is at 49 degrees Celsius. Which is just perfect. So I got a little bowl. I put some ice in it and some water, and I'm just gonna cool it down. Now, remember, we're cooling it down because we want to bring it down so that we promote type 4 and type 5 crystals from forming. Somebody said the untempered looks molded. Did you mean melted? It definitely looks super shiny right now. What's interesting is if you heat up untempered chocolate and you actually do it, so you're untempering the chocolate instead of tempering it by heating it up super high, when it's like melted, it's going to be very nice and shiny. But once it cools down, we're going to get a really dull looking texture. You can see that almost no light shines off this untempered chocolate. So just because it's shiny when it's melted, I learned that it definitely doesn't mean that you did it right. So I am going to just stir it. This is a little bit of a lengthy process, just waiting for it to cool down and heat up again. But this is what chocolatiers do whenever you're buying like chocolate and you see that it's shiny. This is definitely a process that happened that can get a little bit quicker once you practice with it. So it's much better to get it to a precise temperature than go too fast. So this ice bath has definitely helped cool it down. It's at 44 degrees Celsius right now. We are waiting for it to get to 27 degrees Celsius. And you guys, I just want you to know that working with chocolate is not a clean job. I have chocolate everywhere. It's in my hair, it's on my face, it's on my working board. So yeah, somebody asked, could you do it with white chocolate? I see that somebody answered, but just to expand on that, you totally can do it with white chocolate, but it is harder. White chocolate has less cocoa in it. And remember when someone asked, what's the thing that creates crystals? It's the cocoa in it, right? So if you have less cocoa in it, then tempering is just gonna be a little bit more difficult for you. It can be done, and it's definitely done because white chocolate is still shiny, but it's gonna be a little bit more difficult, which is the reason why I chose 90% cocoa chocolate. It's definitely not my favorite chocolate. I don't like it, it's bitter, but it gets you the shiniest kind of look. So yeah, that's a really good question though. You can do it with milk chocolate too. It's just dark always works best for that. We can see that we're cooling down exponentially. We're at 35 degrees Celsius. And we're just waiting for that to get to 27 degrees Celsius. Just gonna make sure that we stir it to get it nice and even. Also, if you end up doing it with more chocolate definitely helps. So what we're actually going to do after this is we're going to wait for this to cool down to about 27 degrees. We're almost there. We got 5 degrees left. And then what we're going to do is we're going to heat it back up to 31 degrees, because we are again trying to make type 5 crystals, and type 5 crystals melting point is 37 degrees. So if we take it to 31 degrees, that's going to be perfect, because we won't have melting of that type 5 crystals that we're so desperately trying to make. I will actually show you one of the chocolates that I tempered yesterday. And you might not get the shininess that you see in chocolate bars at home, just because you're obviously not a professional, but we can clearly see that it has a little bit of a shine. If you can see that, it has a nice little like gloss to it.
that we didn't see in the dull chocolate.
So now we are at 29 degrees, so we are pretty close. So we're gonna start heating the water again. And once we heat it up again, instead of cooling it in the ice bath, what we're gonna do is we're gonna slather it onto the marble slab and wait for that to cool. And the reason why professional chefs and in professional kitchens, we use marble slabs is because marble slabs are really cool. So they definitely help with the cooling process, especially now that I've had this like nice ice bath on top of my marble slab. It's gonna be super cool. I'm gonna put parchment paper under it just because I don't want it to stick. We're gonna slather it really thin so that hopefully you guys will be able to see the final like nice shiny product, and then we'll compare it to the untempered chocolate. I see that you guys are trying to get the video to a lot of likes in the chat. That's cute. Somebody said marble slab, like the ice cream shop. I actually searched up marble slab yesterday to get a photo of it, and I did realize that the shop is called marble slab, which I thought was interesting. I never really thought about it. So we are now at 27.5 degrees Celsius. That's why it's super important to have a candy thermometer, because they are more precise. And with chocolate tempering, remember, temperature is the most important thing. So we are monitoring that temperature really closely. I'm going to get the thermometer, put it back in, and we are trying to raise it to 31 degrees Celsius. So I'm just going to help stir that. Another important thing to note is if you accidentally do get steam in this chocolate, it's going to form like little white bubbles on the chocolate. It's almost going to look like that old chocolate, like at the end of your mom's purse. So we don't want to get any water or steam into it. We want to make sure that it's nice and dry, or else it may look untempered, even though that it is. But that is just a result of steam that we're going to see some bubbles in, and I'll actually show you what it looks like if you accidentally contaminate it with some water. We can see in this photo over here that we saw before, that we have those little white bits over there and those little white looking bubbles, and those white looking bubbles are just probably water that got into the chocolate accidentally. It's pretty easy to get water into the chocolate because you are again working on top of this double boiler that does have water. Another question that I actually haven't gotten yet, but that when I presented to my friends, they asked me is, why do we use a double boiler? Why don't we just put it directly on the heat? And the reason for that is a double boiler is much easier to control. Since you're not putting it directly on the heat, you can't accidentally heat it up too much or too little quickly by accident. You can control it a little bit more when you have the double boiler, since you got the bowl that's on top of that boiled water. It does take some more time though. So we now got it to 31 degrees Celsius. So again, we're gonna use our oven mitt because it is hot. And we are going to put that in our ice bath, and what I'm gonna do is turn off the heat. Super important to do that, just safety again. Put this water aside. Whew, it was getting hot in here. I'm really glad to turn that off. And I have my marble slab right over here, and I'm going to spread our nice cool chocolate on this. I'm just gonna go grab some nice parchment paper. Somebody asked Fiona just right before, for an induction stove, can you put it right on the stove? You definitely, no matter what type of stove you use, you can put it on top. But again, it's gonna be harder to control the heat. And if you accidentally heat it up too much, then you're going to untemper your chocolate by accident. So in order to control it better, I really do recommend using a double boiler. If you're a little bit younger though, there are definitely some safety concerns. So be sure you ask your parents to get that under control. Someone's asking where the chocolate is. You guys are a little impatient, you wanna see it. So here's the chocolate. I got my parchment paper on my nice cool surface. I'm gonna spread it really, really thin so that you guys can see the final shiny product by the end of the stream. So while we play our Kahoot game, this chocolate is just gonna help. This marble slab is gonna help cool down the chocolate. You can see how nice it looks, right? Like, it looks very shiny. Somebody asked, how much chocolate are we using? Well, Mahar, you can use as much as chocolate as you want, but the more chocolate that you use, it's gonna be easier to control it just because it's gonna heat up the entire thing and it's a larger amount. So I do recommend using more. I use 2 full chocolate bars, but You can use more, you can use less. Either way, it works. Just make sure you choose like a suitable size bowl so that most of your chocolate doesn't get lost to the bowl. As you can see, like I got quite a bit of chocolate just kind of left there. Hopefully that answers your question. I've seen people temper chocolate in baking shows. Yeah, it's anytime you buy chocolate bars, they're all tempered. That's the reason why your chocolate bars are very visually appealing. Anytime you buy chocolate from outside, most of the time it's going to be tempered. Anytime that you see untempered chocolate is probably when you buy like chocolate in bulk. Have you seen where you can go and just get those big chocolate chunks that are meant for melting? Those are typically not tempered. So you can find untempered chocolate if you want, but tempered chocolate looks better, which is why chocolatiers do this. So as you can see, everybody's asking me where the pin is. We'll get to that in the next slide. Don't worry. We're just going to worry about slathering this chocolate really nice and thin on this. And I want you guys to see this. The reason why we're doing it thin, that's not the best idea if you want to like eat this chocolate, is because I want it to solidify quickly so that at the end of the Kahoot game it'll be ready. Oops. And that looks pretty good. If we put it straight on the marble slab like professional chefs do, we do have to scrape it off, which you won't be able to see the shininess of the chocolate as well, which is the reason I didn't do that. So that should be nice and thin and good. So now to the part that literally everybody has been waiting for this entire time, the Kahoot. Okay, so I'm just gonna press play and get you guys that pin. I know Kahoot, I can definitely understand why you guys wanna play it so bad. It was my favorite part of school. Whenever we had like review days before tests, we'd have a Kahoot. People went hard for Kahoots. It's not just a little game. So hopefully you guys can see the pin there. And this very loud noise, I'm just gonna turn that off because it overpowers my voice a little bit. But maybe we'll just turn it on while we're waiting. Just. I feel like the music makes it so much more exciting. I love it. See one player that's in. Just gonna give it a minute. Oh, the usernames are decided. That's weird. I changed the settings so that it wouldn't be like that. Sorry, guys. I did change it so you can make your own names, but I guess that didn't work. So just in the chat, I'll ask who won, and then you can tell me who your username was. That way we can get a little shout out for the person who won. I'm gonna go ahead and turn that off. I know it's a very exciting part of the game, having that music. It feels like Jeopardy. I love it personally, but it's a little too loud. So I'll just give it, since I see there's people still rolling in, I'll give that like one more minute. People seem excited for this. It's just based on the content. Fiona said, I won't be able to play Kahoot, but I can watch it. That's totally fine, Fiona. It's just to summarize what we learned in this lesson today. So no worries. Can you make your own username? Unfortunately, it doesn't seem like you can. I did change the settings to allow you guys to make your own usernames, but I don't know what happened there. And I'm not sure how to change that. So definitely my next stream, I will make sure that you guys can pick your own usernames. Sorry about that. Okay. There's still people coming in. Let's give it another 30 seconds. I'm Focused Bat. Yeah, they're quite weird names. I don't know where they get these. I did like making my own names, I know, when I was in school. Can you move your video? It may block the answer. Absolutely. Let me just minimize that a little bit. Good catch. Okay, seems like there's 17 players. Let's get that started. So if you're not in, I'll give you like 5 more seconds, get in there. Okay, let's go. Okay, getting started. Oh, my video's blocking that. Sorry guys, I'll move it. So the question is, what is it called when chocolate is streaky and white? Can I take the video out? If that would be easier for you guys. Sure. There we go. You can see my face later. We don't have to worry about that. So, bloomed. We had 3 people get it. I don't know if it was directly mentioned in the chat, but yes, when we do have chocolate, let me just go back to this photo. When we see those little white spots on the chocolate, that's called blooming. And also, you remember I mentioned type 6 crystals that form after weeks. That white, like, little residue that it leaves, or the little bubbles, that is also called blooming. So, good job to the 3 people who got it. And the second answer was tempered. Tempered should not be streaky and white. It should be nice and like shiny. I see someone thought ugly boy was funny. I don't know why I put that there. I was just testing. Just a funny answer. Okay, the next question is, why is chocolate dark? Why is dark chocolate is what I meant. Better for tempering than white or milk? So just waiting for that. Okay. So the answer to that, I see you guys don't see my page anymore. There we go. Sorry guys, not sure what that was about. So the answer is milk chocolate contains fat that acts as an impurity to cocoa butter fat. So again, this was not directly mentioned, but I just want you guys to learn from these. So, milk chocolate contains fat that acts as impurity. Remember that cocoa butter is that fat and it helps make the crystals. So if there's another fat in it, then obviously it's going to mess with the crystals. I see there are some technical difficulties. Someone needs the game pin. That's just at the very bottom of the page. You can see that I am streaming. So hopefully you'll be able to get in that. It didn't show the right choices. I do see that on my screen, but the answer was just that milk chocolate has impurities. Hopefully you guys can see this next question. Why does tempering create chocolate with a signature snap? That's the next question. It's stretched. Let me try and fix that for you guys. Sorry about that. Not sure why we're having some technical difficulties there, but I'll get that fixed. It's probably just gonna get off the screen just for 1 second. Here we go. And let me fix the size. Sorry about that. Fit to screen. Okay, hopefully you can see that. Okay. So, the answer for this, why does tempering create chocolate with a signature snap, is because type 5 crystals, which we mentioned so many times in this stream, is promoted, and these are tightly packed, and when they're tightly packed, when you break them, it's going to create a nice snap. Let's go to the next question. Why do we reheat chocolate to 31 degrees Celsius once it's all completely melted? Remember guys, that was our last step when we tempered the chocolate. It was our last heating right before we put it onto this cool marble slab. So you can see a chart there. It might help you answer the question if you can't answer. So the answer to this is this is above the melting point of all of the crystals that we don't want to form, and it's below the melting point that we do want to form. So for that reason, we form type 5 crystals, but we don't form type 1 to 4 crystals. Okay, podium. We got third place, Diligent Eagle. Feel free to comment who you are if you're the winner. I can say your name. Second place, we got Bronze Raven. And first place, we got Clever Dino. So good job, guys. I really like that game. Super fun. And let me know if you liked it so we can do more Kahoots. Okay, the finished product. So while we've been playing this Kahoot, we have our chocolate that has been nicely cooling here. It's not 100% cool, but it's pretty good. And I'm going to show you how beautiful and glossy that this chocolate is. So might not see it from that angle, but
we can see that the light definitely does glisten on it a lot more than the chocolate that we started out with. We can see that it is shiny. So the tempering did work, which I am happy that it did. I'll compare it side by side to the one that's dull, and hopefully you can see the difference. So this is the one that's dull. You can definitely see that there's not quite as much as a shine to it. It's a little bit, and for some reason the shades look a little bit different in the camera, but I can assure you that they're the same. They're the same chocolate. So this is much more shiny. You can see that the light bounces on it. It is glossy. Someone said, Fiona said, wow, that looks really good, and I agree. I want you guys to hear the snap too. It's a little quiet because again, it's thin, but we can hear that there is that snap. It's not as, if I like press it, it's not as crumbly as the dark chocolate. We can see that the dark chocolate crumbles really easily actually. Or the untempered chocolate. And it's dull, so we can definitely see that difference. Someone said that they can hear it. ASMR, I love ASMR, I'm glad. We got to incorporate that in today's stream. I'm just going to show you all of it. It comes off the parchment really nicely, so it's cooled down just in time. So that is our finished, glossy, beautiful chocolate. That is the result of tempering. That is when crystals line up. Jackie said he was Bronze Raven, so yay, good for him for winning. It was definitely a little bit of a more challenging test. I'm really glad that this worked out. It looks like super beautiful chocolate. So let's just summarize what we learned in today's stream. So we learned that it's really beautiful how much science there actually is when you are cooking and in the kitchen and professional kitchens. You can think about, like, have you ever heard of like liquid nitrogen ice cream? That's definitely, you got some science in that. We saw some science here with chocolate tempering. So we can see that there really is science just everywhere around us. We learned that through temperature manipulation, we can favor the formation of some crystals and not other crystals that we don't want. So again, we're isolating for certain crystals, and we learned that in chocolate tempering, we use the tempering procedure to form type 5 crystals. And we also learned that tempered chocolate has that beautiful snap that we heard, and it's glossy and shiny. Okay, just one last thing before we leave is that we are recruiting people to interview for a new series that we have that will be coming up in the next upcoming weeks. Just anybody who worked on a STEM project, who thinks that they are comfortable being interviewed and want to be featured on the channel, please feel free to go to this email and send your application in, and that would be great. We would love to see you guys on our channel. So thanks so much for watching, guys. I had a lot of fun for my first live stream. I was pretty nervous before my stream, but I think it went really well. We made some beautiful chocolate. Thanks, everybody, for joining. Bye, Jackie. Bye, Bella. Bye, everyone. It was a really great stream. Thanks, guys, for joining. And we, again, are here every weekday at 11 a.m., so come back tomorrow, and we have an episode called Space Time FaceTime. Sounds really exciting, so make sure you don't miss that. And I will see you next Thursday. Bye, guys.